but in all my years writing about the architecture of historic country houses, I've visited a great many around the British Isles, but I rarely get to spend more than a day or two at any one of them. In this series, I'm going to be spending my weekends in six very different country houses, relishing their architecture, digging into the family's history, and also having a bit of fun with the families that live in them now.
This weekend, I've been invited down to the Cotswolds. Chavenage is the quintessential English manor house, and I'm curious to see just how a place like this works.
I think we might have a bit of a problem here. Seems like we've got a flat tyre.
That's bad luck.
Chavenage is about another 500 yards up the road.
Well, I just walked there, shall I?
Thanks
so much.
Sorry about that.
Ah well, a short country walk on a pleasant afternoon is no great hardship.
Oh, lovely.
Although I'll be staying on a working farm, I'm rather hoping I won't be asked to do anything too strenuous.
Well, that was well worth the walk, a sight for sore eyes and sore feet. Beautiful English manor house, stretching out its wings in a welcoming fashion. And the date, 1576, is carved on the porch.
Hello, how are you?
Good to see you.
It was lovely to see Caroline again, whom I'd last met when I came to visit her parents, David and Rona Loseley Williams, to do a feature about this Grade 1 listed house. We set off down Tudor passages and winding staircases on the way to my bedroom.
And there is a bathroom just in the corner there. Make yourself at home.
Brilliant.
Then come and join us for a cup of tea or something downstairs.
See you in a short while. Thanks very much, Karen.
Here at last. Classic Cotswold Manor House bedroom. Nice high old-fashioned beds. All the windows open, nice and fresh. Big old brown furniture, as it should be. Well, the curious thing is that there are four doors leading out of this one room.
Anyway, I'm ready for my cup of tea.
I expect to take milk.
Yes, please.
Once I'd remembered where the kitchen was, I found David and Rona had the tea ready. Their son George had popped in to meet me, and the weekend's entertainment was already fully scheduled.
The slight downside, Jeremy, is we've got quite a busy time ahead. We've got a wedding coming up and things, so there's quite a lot of sort of housework.
And that's part of the weekend, then?
That's part of the Chavenage experience,
your
I think.
So how do the weddings get started here?
Somebody arrived around and went, what a lovely place for a wedding. You know, can we hire the house? We'll pay
but
for
we
it.
We do. Well, it's a very delicate balancing act between being too commercial and making it almost not worth living in it.
Mm. I think the people wandering in the house are always love seeing a lived-in house. You know, people come up from the car park, they have to step over a bicycle, probably fall over a football. And the other thing you'll discover in the house is because we all live so close by, we don't use the telephone at all, we just shout. I think that's a symptom of a big house.
It's a testament to the house and the estate that you all love living here. That says a lot.
You'll meet Joanna, my sister, who actually lives in part of the house a little later on, and she does quite a lot of this catering here for the events and things, not so much the weddings now.
It's all very symbiotic.
It is, very.
I can't guarantee it.
George, do you live in another wing of the house?
No, Jeremy, I've got a farmhouse where my family and I live up about a mile and a half up the other end of the farm, so we're slightly separated from the commune down here.
Glorious isolation. Dad, your group will be here any minute.
Goodness me, you're absolutely right, Caroline.
David was taking a guided tour around the house, and I was looking forward to seeing him in action.
A very warm welcome to Chavenage on this lovely morning.
It's immediately clear that David is an entertaining performer, and the fact he knows his script backwards from constant repetition doesn't detract from his obvious enjoyment of giving the tour.
It's exactly as he left it.
David is certainly very pleased that his home has made it onto television so often.
Just glance at these photographs. You might recognise David Suchet as Hercule Poirot. Casualty. Sublime to the ridiculous. The cast of Are You Being Served?
Well, that's very sweet. It's like a proud father of a little starlet who's made it big in the movies.
Near the end of his tour, David tells the story of an event that all country house owners must dream of. He found something valuable in the attic.
Now, in 1970, we had an amazing find in our attics. We found a portfolio of 72 drawings. They were all signed by King George IV, and they were the designs for the redecoration of his private apartments at Windsor Castle. So I wrote to Windsor and had a very nice letter back from the librarian saying my letter had been shown to the Queen, and she was very keen to have her pictures back. But she insisted on paying the full market price. Yes.
Paid for a new roof.
And I've been very keen on George IV ever since. But I do have to come clean and admit I did keep two or three back. Or to be strictly accurate, three or four. I'm sure you won't tell the Queen that next having tea together.
I love these little rooms of the English country houses with their cartoons and family photographs. Perhaps this one is just a little bit forbidding, with the squire looking down at you while you're doing your business. Not the first person I expected to meet in the smallest room.
Opening to the public certainly contributes to the upkeep of the house, but it can also cause problems of its own.
The major problem with having a lot of people in the house, of course, is as soon as they arrive here, they all want to go to the loo. You use so much loo paper. I mean, that's our biggest expense now is loo paper. And then the cesspit is now a major problem. And when great-grandfather put it in, it was designed for, you know, a household and a few extras to go to the loo. Now when you've got 100 ladies peeing twice on a visit, you know, it's a hell of a lot. And
it's putting a strain on the technology.
It is, yes.
Well, whatever problems lurk out of sight, there's no hint of them when you view the house from the lawn on a summer's evening like this. It has the perfection that has grown organically from various different periods of building.
And here we are looking at the main garden front at Chavenage House. Wonderful image of an English manor house, beautifully composed, but over various different dates.
You've got the core Tudor manor house in the middle, built by the Stevens family, the original owners. And you can see the wobbly roof.
Whereas this building and these sort of crenellated bay windows, looking like a little sort of castle turret bit, added probably around 1800, early 19th century.
And then, far over there, a gracious bow window of an Edwardian ballroom, added after the Loseley Williamses bought the house just over 100 years ago.
And beyond it, the church, which apparently began life as a folly. Each stage adding to the overall picturesque composition. This is the Edwardian servants' wing of the house that you can see from the rather abrupt roof. It was never quite finished properly. There would have been a pitched roof running through the chimney stack. And although built for the servants, today it's where the family really live in the house. Here's one of the follies in the park, a little romantic Gothic arch on a ruined building around. I'm sure it was always built to look ruined, because no one would ever construct a useful building out of this volcanic rock known as tufa rock, which gives it this lovely, aged, almost having emerged from the soil look. Even these two gnarled stumps were probably put there 200 years ago to be part of the decoration, but now overshadowed by tall trees and covered with ivy, it's probably even closer to the romantic image that the builders had when they put it up.
Well, that's enough fresh air. I was ready for a cup of tea, so I headed for the north wing, where younger daughter Joanna lives with her family. But it seemed if I wanted a snack with my cuppa, I'd have to join Henry and Annabelle as a lowly kitchen assistant.
Can I eat this?
Yes, you can.
This Operation Chocolate Cake.
Chocolate brownies.
Chocolate brownies. That's what
I think we need aprons for grown-ups as well.
Joanna, a graduate of Prudy's Cookery School, now runs her own catering business from a converted barn on the estate.
When did you move to this wing then?
When Annabelle was about 6 months old.
Right, so you've been here.
But we were in a cottage, garden cottage, in the garden. So we haven't moved far.
No, not.
In my life. I haven't moved far in my life.
No. Where should this go now?
Okay, on the Argo, chaps. One for you.
One for me.
One for you.
Do I get to lick this when it's got chocolate on it?
No licking yet.
Just a little bit of butter to go now, isn't it?
It's going to be rather dangerous, breaking eggs.
I'll have a go.
Beautifully done.
You realise you're eating this for tea?
I'm looking forward to it.
I had hoped to talk to Joanna about her life at Chavenage, but the kids had other ideas.
Well, can I do a bit of stirring?
Tell them how to do it. Get all those corners.
I just get that corners in.
It's very gooey.
Let's pour it into there, otherwise you won't have anything for tea. It's all well mixed, I hope, Jeremy.
I did my best. I don't have quite the training you do, of course.
Chavenage is still very much a family home. And although Joanna has her wing, and Caroline lives in a cottage, and George his farmhouse down the lane, there's still one room in the house that they all still use. And I've asked Caroline to let me have a look at it.
Fantastic.
I told you it's going to be slightly untidy.
But this was made as one bedroom.
This is great granny's bedroom.
And how often does it get tidied up? From time to time.
Rarely, rather. Since we've been having the weddings and things in the house, you need somewhere to store furniture. And it was all brought up here. I would say it was a set designer's utopia. You can get everything you want in here.
A Savile Row pith helmet.
Great-grandfather went to the Boer War.
There's a Loseley Williams there. Does he look like the current generation?
Well, that's Dad. Eaton in 1946.
Ancient gin bottle here with pink paraffin written on it.
Probably my great-aunt's. That was our toy cupboard, and right. You can see...
Escape from Colditz,
yes.
Looks like Africa in 1932. There's an amazing set of things here. And I love the nursery books mixed up with the magistrate's court guide.
I was very keen on being a vet, so there's the whole sort of James Herriot collection. I mean, we just keep it. There was talk of actually making it into a nice bedroom again, but those plans were shelved. One day, when we all break our legs, we're going to come up here and have a good tidy up.
Well, I got to smarten up for supper now, and tonight I'm going to be meeting two new members of the family, Joanna's husband James and David's sister, great aunt Tricia.
My grandmother was a great character, and she was commandant of the local military hospital in both World Wars.
She's quite keen on her gambling. That kept her going.
Yes.
And on her deathbed, she was still asking what Peter O'Sullivan had recommended in the Daily Express.
Wasn't really a very good mixture. Betting. Gin and...
bright red, dyed hair.
And when she was ill and had an oxygen tent, she still had a telephone inside the oxygen tent to do her betting.
James, can you remember your first visit?
I was on a working visit, but like you, Jeremy. and I remember meeting Joanna slaving away over the kitchen stove.
And then Thunderbolt City.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Joanna came through and said, really good news, we're engaged. And I can visualise a lovely summer wedding at Chavenage. I opened the booking diary, is it? Sorry. The only date was November the 14th.
Yes, you'll have to wait for cancellation.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that was it.
You seem to enjoy having the public in, though. You seem to get pleasure out of it in a hospitable way.
Well, one thing I learned from my father, and I think he was absolutely right, if you've got to do something, you might just as well enjoy it.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't have to have that glass of port, but I did enjoy it. I made sure I didn't have too many on learning that I was due on parade the next morning at 5:30 for a meet of the Beaufort Hunt. I was looking forward to a good night's sleep. I woke in the dead of night to a strange noise, and being a conscientious guest, I felt I ought to check for burglars.
Sorry.
Jeremy!
Oh, dear. Oh, tally-ho. Well, it's 6 o'clock in the morning, and you can certainly tell the hounds are here. And how often do you hunt yourself?
Well, most Mondays.
Oh, that's nice.
Yes. I used to hunt 3 days a week. Took up a lot of our time. Oh, yeah.
And always with the Beaufort yourself?
Always with the Beaufort, oh, yeah. Ever since I've been a small child.
Following family tradition, Henry sets out on his first hunt. This corner of the estate, Chavenage Green, was where the Hundred Court met in the 9th century, a little bit of our ancient history kept alive by the Beaufort, who meet here often during the season, although probably for not much longer.
It's a lovely sound.
You could recognise any of the hounds by name?
Yeah.
Instantly.
Not very good with people.
Do you hunt with the Beaufort as a child as well? As well?
Oh, very much so.
Yeah.
Very much so.
So long memories here.
Long memories. Yeah. I had an accident and I was off for a year.
Right.
Somehow I just sort of, petered out.
Yeah. And when you have a breeze like this, what does it do to the scent?
A little bit, no problem. But it's usually best when it's getting colder. It keeps it down, and then it'll go like stink.
As horses and hounds departed, Caroline offered to ferry us off in search of the action. But it soon became clear that the best way to follow a hunt is on a horse.
Can you see them at the top there?
We got tantalising glimpses between trees, listened to hearsay.
I've seen a fox and a deer.
We even saw a lone hound cross the horizon. But it seemed we were not destined to see a fox. Eventually, master and huntsman returned to the house for a substantial breakfast and discussion of the morning's events. Rona produced a seemingly endless supply of sausages, which disappeared nonetheless. It had been a hectic morning thus far, and I settled in a sunny window with PG Woodhouse to recuperate.
Jeremy! Jeremy, there you are. You couldn't do me a favour.
Well, it was certainly true that I'd expressed an interest in the workings of the estate.
I'd been sent off to help, Paddy. What could I do?
I felt I was getting a little more of the country house experience than I had bargained for. My latest challenge was to split a few logs for Paddy, Chavenage's invaluable jack of all trades.
I'm a pro at this, Paddy. It's not going in very far, I'm
afraid. Come on, Jeremy.
Let me have another go. Okay. There we go, that's satisfying.
That's very good.
Improving?
You're improving. Different from London, isn't it?
Very different.
Do you think you'll be all right here?
I'll do my best.
Just see if you can crack a few more of them before lunch, huh?
Okay.
Well, you're never too old to learn a new skill, but it makes you think of all the physical effort that goes into the running of these houses.
Well, it's nice to enjoy the fruits of my labours, because these great old houses can often be pretty chilly, even in the height of summer. And I'm sitting in the great hall, and it's fascinating to look around and see the evidence of architectural salvage through the centuries. This Jacobean chimney piece, almost certainly bought here from another house, and these wonderful fragments of medieval stained glass in the windows, absolutely beautiful, collected up around 1800 and put into these windows in these rather crazy and fabulous patterns. This particularly handsome one here is not what you might think. It's not the Pope just giving a lady's boob a tweak. It's actually God creating Eve out of Adam's rib. Well, having seen the family junk room yesterday, I'm a bit puzzled why all that stuff in there isn't up in the attics. Apparently, that's a question I've got to ask David, who's up there now. David? David?
Hello.
Hello. It's incredible. It just goes on and on and on. Fantastic.
This is where I escape from my women folk.
How long have you been working on it, David?
40 years.
So did it begin in one tiny corner and gradually...
This was the original.
This was the first place.
Little bit, yeah. Yeah. They take about a minute and a half to do the circuit at a scale 70 miles an hour.
And you've got whole townscapes.
Oh, I've got various scenarios.
I think it's magnificent.
David's layout has now spread across all the four main attics of the house, through tunnels and walls, over beams and rafters, encompassing British and continental sections. It's a testament to his imagination and his sense of humour.
This is the officer's mess. Naughty young officer spying on the young lady sunbathing. You can see here underneath the poor chappie going through the railings.
Oh, Lord.
All this will have scenery round.
So there's a great long-term vision for us.
Oh, yes.
Lots still
well,
to
you
do.
See, that's the beauty of a hobby like this. It never finishes.
Yeah.
Helen? Oh, hell. All right, well, come give me a hand. I've got someone staying. I'll ask him. OK, see you in a minute. Jeremy?
Come on! Come on!
It seems the cows aren't where they should be. A simple matter to rectify, you'd think. Historically, this was sheep country, and Cotswold manor houses were often built on the profits of the wool trade. But today, Chavenage is a mixed farm, and these are Rona's dairy cows.
They're running out of puff, but they're going in the right direction.
That side of the fence!
I wouldn't argue with her girls. It's magnificent countryside. And looking across the valley, I see the battlements of Beverston Castle. And there's a story about Beverston that I want to check out back at the house.
Well, I'm just exiting one of the many doors of my bedroom. Hang off on a bit of an explore around these windy corridors. I'm quite interested to see if I can find a certain window. Because in the Civil War period, it said that Beverston Castle across the valley there was taken by the parliamentarians because the owner had a special code with a lady who lived at Chavenage for secret romance. She would put a candle in the window, he would know it was the all clear and come over and see her. And sadly, the parliamentarian army found this out and got her to do the signal. So he came over and his castle was captured. So I think I'm going to delve into this promising little room. Yeah, but I think I must have told you to carry on this way. So it's funny how these old houses often have quite grand bedrooms leading one from another. So you never quite know if there's somebody very posh next door about to burst in. I think it carries on. We're back out in a corridor here. Now this would be the right side for it, over the garden. Come into Queen Anne's room, rather dinky little plate. Doesn't really look like a room you'd put a queen up in, but very charming nonetheless. And this must be the view, I think. You can quite clearly see Beverston here, so it's quite conceivable that a candle was put in this window. One of the things I love about this house are all the funny little fiddly bits you find. Newel posts made up of what look like old bedposts. And here you've got these little gothic-y, almost Saracen-like windows, all introduced, no doubt, by some early 19th century antiquarian, adding another layer of romance to this already very romantic house.
That evening, I felt I was in for a more cerebral time as the Scrabble set came out, together with the Imperial Dictionary of 1864. But the tone was lowered right from the start when Caroline put her panties on the table.
Panties!
I see something I can do, I think. M-A-S-C-L-E-D.
Muscle.
Rubbish.
Absolutely true, darling.
French.
Muscle armour, made up of sort of lozenge-shaped little bits of metal.
David's military erudition was a tough act to follow, but I thought I saw an opening for an architectural response.
Swint.
Switch.
Just have a word. Dad's checking it.
Oh, you're absolutely right. A squinch. A small, pendant-shaped arch.
I survived with honour intact to win the day.
God, I didn't agree to get on a horse this morning as well. Oh.
I slept rather too well after the exertions of the previous day and only just made it to church on time.
Morning, Reverend everybody. Welcome to the service of Holy Communion.
This beautiful estate church, mostly built in the 19th century, is used for Holy Communion once a month. And again, it's a family affair, with young Henry taking the collection. The Loseley Williamses are Roman Catholics, but rather generously they maintain this as an Anglican church, as there is a Chavenage tradition that the services should follow the denomination of the majority who live on the estate.
Well, George, thank you very much indeed once again.
Very kind.
The service provides another excuse for a get-together as clergy and congregation convene in the kitchen for the ecumenical rite of coffee. I took the opportunity to catch up with George and his wife Lucy and ask them how they saw the future of Chavenage.
Well, I think the problem I have is that I'm actually relatively close in age to my father, and, you know, he wants to be carried out in a box, and that's fine. And what I hope is that whatever happens, the Lucy Williamses will stay here. Whether I'll be here or my son or his son, I don't know. But as long as, you know, the family is still in, that's what I really hope for, rather than particularly me wanting to live here.
You do work here. You've been running the farm.
Well, I've got lots of kind of strings in my bow at the moment. One of the things we're doing here is obviously diversifying all the land use, and one of the things I've got going is four-wheel drive instruction and publicity. And we've got some cars out here at the moment who are doing some driving around the valley, and it just makes more use of the farm, and we get another little income from it, farm diversification.
Well, I like the sound of that.
It's good, isn't it?
It is good.
Well, that was fantastic. But now from four-wheel drive into super drive, I've agreed to go and help with wedding preparations in the house.
Something I can help with.
Yeah. We'll just come back at the legs.
Come on, boys. Well done, boys. And big boy.
There's no little machine that does this for you. Oh, no, his tail's under. Is that it then, Karen?
No. Now I've got to bring in tables.
They're quite heavy, aren't they?
Yeah. Do the work.
I've heard that before.
You can come every Sunday.
Oh, lovely. We've got it pretty much under control.
We're nearly there.
Just a few minutes we can go and pack my bag before the cab comes.
Yeah, you could escape.
Okay.
Dismissed.
Sure. Yeah, sure. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Not at all. It's a pleasure. Great weekend. Everyone's been very kind. Been incredibly energetic. I don't think I've ever had such an energetic weekend away. But I sense the wedding party approaching and perhaps the time to make my farewells before I'm roped in to serve drinks to the guests. Well, thanks so much, Emma. It's been tremendous fun.
It had been fun, but now I was looking forward to a relaxing week at work. How will they survive without me?
Come back next weekend.
Thank you so much.
We'll see you around.
What a pleasure.
Another bride, another June.
Here come the happy couple.
Another sunny honeymoon. Another season. Another reason for making whoopee. But don't forget, folks, that's what you get, folks, for making whoopee.